this webinar entitled Killing Biofilm, Mission Impossible by Håkon, Valen, Senior Scientist at NIOM. What you see now is an image of a biofilm, a bacterial community. All the spherical, circular dots you see represent a bacterium. In a biofilm, the bacteria are growing in close contact with each other. Living in a bacterial community is beneficial and is the preferred mode of growth for bacteria outside the laboratory. A biofilm is defined as a community of bacteria that is attached to a surface or to each other, surrounded by an extracellular matrix produced by the bacteria themselves. The extracellular matrix is an important component of the biofilm and contributes to the many characteristic properties of biofilms. This is an image of a typical supragingival located dental biofilm. Dental bacteria biofilm communities are unique, with variation in bacterial amount and composition among and within individuals. Approximately 700 species have been described to colonize the oral cavity. Of them, approximately 400 to 500 are found subgingivally only. This makes the oral cavity one of the most diverse microbiomes in the humans. Interestingly, the enormous number of bacteria residing in the oral cavity was acknowledged already 300 years ago by the Dutch tradesman and scientist Antimicrobial van Leeuwenhoek. He studied dental plaque in his homemade microscope and he wrote, "There are more animals living in the scum on the teeth in a man's mouth than there are men in a whole kingdom." In addition to bacteria, the oral cavity may also be a home for viruses and fungal species. However, the latter normally constitutes only a small part of the microbiota. The extracellular matrix is an important component of biofilm. The central role of bacteria produce polysaccharides for bacterial adhesion to surfaces and to each other, and as an important component in biofilms, was described under the biofilm concept by Bill Costerton. Costerton is considered by many as the father of the biofilm concept, with his publication How Bacteria Stick in the late 1970s. However, research from the Foresight Institute had already described the important role of bacterial-produced polysaccharides for adhesion of the caries-associated bacteria Streptococcus mutans. The decades to follow has learned us more about the components and importance of the matrix surrounding the bacteria in a biofilm. The dental biofilm extracellular matrix may be made up of polysaccharides from the sugar sucrose. Bacteria such as Streptococcus mutans has been shown to produce polysaccharides, which may contribute to the structure of the biofilm, but also nutrition to the inhabitants of the biofilm. Proteins in the biofilm may have important function for structure and adhesion, but also for remodeling and release of nutrients by enzymes from the extracellular matrix. Enzymes may also be involved in dispersion of bacteria from the biofilm. This may enable bacteria to colonize new sites in the oral cavity. DNA, the hereditary material found inside all cells, have also been shown to be an important component of the dental biofilm matrix. The DNA may not just function as a structural component, but may also allow shuffle of genetic material between bacteria. Bacteria in the biofilm may take up extracellular located DNA, which may provide the bacteria with new properties. This has gained much interest relating to the global increase and spread of bacteria with resistance to antibiotics. Formation of the dental biofilm starts immediately after cleaning of the tooth. An organic film of proteins known as the dental pellicle will absorb to the exposed dental hard tissues. The molecules in this organic film may aid in adhesion of bacteria. The first bacteria to adhere will adhere to the pellicle. However, later colonizers may bind to already adhered bacteria. Co-aggregation, that is, adhesion of genetically distinct bacteria to each other, has been described to play a pivotal role in dental biofilm formation and is a widespread phenomenon among oral bacteria. The early colonizing microbiota has been shown to be dominated by streptococcal species. If left undisturbed, the composition of the biofilm will become more complex. The number of species able to join the biofilm increases. The bacteria in the biofilm may help each other in breaking down food. What is excreted from one bacteria may be the dinner of another. Nutritional cooperation may be an important factor for the generation of dental multi-species biofilm communities. If left undisturbed, further maturation and increase in complexity of the biofilm may occur. Bacteria may detach from the biofilm. Detachment may be mediated by enzymes, which may aid in dispersion of bacteria from the biofilm. Or the bacteria may go with the flow of saliva. Both will enable bacteria to colonize new sites in the oral cavity. Benefits of joining the biofilm community. The dental biofilm have many different inhabitants with different characteristics and properties, where all are embedded in an extracellular matrix. The bacteria in biofilms have some important different properties compared to their planktonic, free-floating counterpart that are important for us as clinicians. When in a biofilm, bacteria show increased tolerance for antimicrobial compounds. This may explain why antibacterial agents may have shown to be effective in the laboratory but show only marginal effect in vivo. The bacteria shows increased tolerance toward changes in the environment. The biofilm provides the bacteria with protection against the host immune system. Horizontal gene transfer. This may be acquisition of DNA from the environment. This may give the bacteria new properties. The close contact between bacteria in biofilm may facilitate horizontal gene transfer. Horizontal gene transfer is an important mechanism for the spread of resistance to antimicrobial compounds. Caries is a disease with multifactorial etiology. The amount of biofilm is not the only factor that is important for disease development. However, the amount of biofilm in combination with a diet high in fermentable carbohydrate or reduced amount of saliva may be important for the development of caries. Caries is associated with a dental biofilm with altered ecology. This change favors the growth and dominance of bacterial species with specific properties. Therefore, the objective of biofilm control is to prevent the development of a biofilm that can cause disease. How can this be achieved? Antimicrobials and other treatments are used in dentistry to eliminate and prevent formation of bacterial biofilms. Antimicrobial compounds may be incorporated into such as dental materials to inhibit biofilm formation. Antimicrobials are also used by patients for daily prevention of dental biofilm-associated diseases. The rationale for this is that the mechanical biofilm control is inadequate to prevent the development or progression of dental diseases. An important characteristic for antimicrobial agents used in the oral cavity is the agent's substantivity. That is, the ability of an agent to bind to oral surfaces such as the mucosa and the dental hard surfaces and be released over time. Saliva may mediate the transport from the buccal mucosa to the bacteria in the biofilm on the tooth. The agent's substantivity may provide a concentration above the effective dose for a longer time compared to non-substantive agents. I will shortly discuss some antimicrobial compounds that may be added to products for the prevention of caries development and or progression. Chlorhexidine may be administered by gels, varnishes and mouth rinses. Chlorhexidine is considered the standard other antimicrobial compounds are compared with. Chlorhexidine has a broad antimicrobial effect. One recent Cochrane review reported that there is lack of evidence for the use of chlorhexidine gels and varnishes compared to placebo or no treatment for the prevention of caries in young people and adolescents. Another recent systematic review which investigated the use of chlorhexidine mouth rinses as an anti-caries agent, concluded that it is not possible to conclude whether the use of a chlorhexidine mouth rinse used by patients is effective in preventing development of dental caries. Thus, there is currently lack of conclusive evidence to support the use of chlorhexidine in caries prevention in general. Quaternary ammonium compounds are widely used biocides with a broad antimicrobial effect. The agent cetylpyridinium chloride is a quaternary ammonium compound added to such as mouth rinses and toothpastes. The effect of cetylpyridinium chloride containing mouth rinses as an adjuvant to tooth brushing on plaque was assessed in a systematic review. The authors reported a plaque-reducing effect of cetylpyridinium chloride containing mouth rinses. However, there is lack of evidence from high-quality clinical studies regarding the caries preventive effect. Triclosan is a bisphenol with an antimicrobial effect. The substantivity of triclosan itself in the oral cavity is low. Thus, it is widely used in combination with a cool polymer. A recent Cochrane review reported that a fluoride containing toothpaste with triclosan led to a small reduction in coronal caries compared to control. However, the evidence is based on 4 studies only. Essential oils are extracts from plant material in a solvent. Essential oils are widely used because of their antibacterial properties. Essential oils have a broad antibacterial effect. A systematic review reported that use of essential oils as an adjuvant to mechanical cleaning reduced the amount of biofilm. However, there is lack of conclusive evidence for the caries preventive effect of essential oils. Many agents have been investigated with the purpose to eliminate dental biofilms for caries prevention. However, few agents have a documented caries preventive effect in the long term. This may be caused by either lack of effect of the agent or lack of documentation. To document a caries preventive effect, there is a need for long-term randomized controlled trials with high quality that report on caries incidence and or progression as endpoints. It is not possible to predict the caries preventive effect of an agent based on studies that report surrogate endpoints only, such as altered levels of specific caries-associated bacteria or biofilm mass. Antibiotics are fundamental for modern health services. Thus, the global increase in antibiotic resistance is a threat to our health system. The use of antimicrobials in dental, cosmetics, and other products may cause the bacteria to develop and select for resistance to the antimicrobial agent. Acquired resistance may be caused by de novo mutations in the bacterial DNA or through horizontal gene transfer. Use of antimicrobials may select for cross or co-resistance with clinically used antibiotics. Most evidence for co-occurrence of development of resistance to antibiotics are from studies with quaternary ammonium compounds and triclosan. However, there is also raised concerns for resistance to chlorhexidine. Cross-resistance may occur if the antimicrobial compound selects for bacteria that are resistant towards the antimicrobial compound. However, the resistance mechanism may also confer resistance to antibiotics. This may be caused by an efflux pump. The bacteria are protected by a pump that may transport both compounds out of the bacteria. The use of antimicrobials may also select for bacteria that have genes providing protection both to the antimicrobial compound and to one or more antibiotics, but by different mechanisms. There is much interesting scientific work performed to find new products and strategies for control and elimination of biofilm. However, the use of antimicrobial compounds to prevent dental biofilm formation is a strategy that does not focus on the actual challenge regarding dental biofilms and caries. The compound does not remove the biofilm and the compounds are not specific. To prevent biofilms in one location, we target all bacteria that are living in the oral cavity. We have to remind ourselves that the oral resident microbiota is an important both for oral and general health. The need for antimicrobial agents should be minimized and only used in cases where it is not possible to achieve similar results with altered diet, change in patient behavior, and mechanical cleaning. At present, educating patients in mechanical biofilm disruption in combination with supporting change in modifying lifestyle factors is still the cornerstone to control oral biofilm levels compatible with oral health. Thank you for listening.